I'd like you to come back with me for a few moments to the year 1992. It was the 500th anniversary of Columbus discovering America. And on that day, Americans were celebrating that great anniversary. Little did most people know that there were two radio telescopes that were focused on the heavens. One of them, in fact, was 1,000 feet across. What were they focused on? What did they want to discover? They were wondering, is there anybody out there listening? Are there any aliens out there anyplace? Can we even pick up a faintest ping? Is there somebody out there beyond the stars? Somebody out there in the cosmos? Somebody anywhere out there? Well, we've got incredibly good news for you, and that's this. There is somebody out there. And Daniel discovered that there was somebody out there beyond the stars, that there was a God in heaven. The Bible says in Daniel chapter 10, verse 1, in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a message was revealed to Daniel, whose name was called Belteshazzar. Now, you remember that Belteshazzar is the Babylonian name of Daniel. Bel was the chief god of the Babylonians. They had 13 gods. And so Daniel's name was changed from the Hebrew, which means God is my judge, or God is my vindicator, or God will set all things right. It was changed from that when he was taken captive into Babylon. His name was changed to Belteshazzar, or the keeper, the hid treasures of the leading god of Babylon, Bel. So in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a message was revealed to Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar. And here's what the scripture says. The message was true, but the appointed time was long. And he understood the message and had understanding of the vision. So the message is true, but the appointed time is long. What is that talking about? Daniel was taken captive at 17 years old, or thereabouts, by the Babylonians and brought from Jerusalem to Babylon. This is the third year of Cyrus. Now, the third year of Cyrus is 535 BC. So if you take Daniel's captive by Nebuchadnezzar in 605, and you come down to 535 BC, that means that Daniel had been in captivity for 70 years. He's now 87 years old. The appointed time of the Babylonian captivity was to come to an end. It was a 70-year captivity. The appointed time was long. So Daniel is there praying. He's crying out to God, God, the time is long. God, it's time for our people to go back to Jerusalem. It's time for our people to be released from this bondage. It's time for them to be released from this captivity. You know, you and I are captives in a foreign world, in a world that really is not our home. You remember that old spiritual that says, this world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. We live in a world of sickness and suffering and heartache. We live in a world of disease and disaster and death. We live in a world of calamity, of chaos, of confusion. We live in a world of pestilence, of poverty. We live in a world, in a planet that is just groaning for its deliverance. Don't you agree with me that the appointed time is really long? Don't you agree with me that indeed we too with Daniel cry out, Lord, it's too long. When are you going to deliver us? When are you going to come again? You remember what Jesus said? 2,000 years ago, John 14, verse 1, Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. Jesus promised 2,000 years ago that he would return. And every passing generation has looked forward to, has anticipated, has longed for the coming of Christ. but the appointed time is indeed long. We long for the return of our Lord. We long to see him coming in the clouds with glory and power. We long to see our loved ones again who have died believing in the second coming of Christ, raised from the dead. We long to receive those glorious immortal bodies where there is no more pain or suffering, there is no more cancer, there is no more diabetes, there is no more heart disease, where worry and fear and anxiety are a thing of the past. We long with Daniel for that deliverance. In Daniel chapter 10, verse 2 and 3, the Bible goes on, "In those days I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. I ate no pleasant bread, nor meat or wine came into my mouth, nor did I anoint myself at all for till 3 weeks were fulfilled." Now I need to pause there, and we need to analyze that passage because it could confuse you. Didn't Daniel say in Daniel 1 that he purposed in his heart not to eat of the king's meat or drink of his wine? Why would he say in this passage that no meat or wine came to my mouth? Did that infer that he was drinking wine before? Let me help you understand this passage. Let's look at it. He said he mourned 3 full weeks. What does this mean? It means he's fasting. He eats no pleasant food, fasting. No meat or wine, fasting. And you see that expression, meat or wine, in the Hebrew, that's an idiomatic expression for a total fast. It's not that he was eating meat, it's not that he was drinking wine, but it's a way the Hebrews expressed that he was fasting. We find that clarified where it says, "Nor did I anoint myself at all." Another anointing is also part of that fast till 3 weeks were fulfilled. So what's going on here? Daniel is in this fast, probably likely only drinking water during this period of time, and he's praying earnestly. He's seeking God earnestly. What is he praying about? He knows that the 70-year captivity, as prophesied by Jeremiah, is about ready to come to an end. Daniel knows that. And so he's on his knees praying because the time appointed was long. They were still in captivity. The Babylonians had fallen to the Medes and Persians. Darius was the ruler of the Medes, but now Cyrus is the ruler of the Persians. Cyrus has not yet signed a decree to allow the Jews in captivity to go back to their homeland of Jerusalem. So Daniel is praying for 3 weeks that indeed God would work a miracle for Cyrus to sign the decree. So this really is a call to prayer. When you look at Daniel chapter 10, it's a call to recognize that God is ruler over all, that God is sovereign, and that God respects our freedom of choice, and that as we seek him in prayer, that he will miraculously answer those prayers. So we are going to see in this chapter how God miraculously, God providentially answered Daniel's prayer. And when you and I are on our knees, when we are seeking God, when our hearts are open to God, he then manifests his hand and answers our prayers as well. Daniel 10, verse 4, "Now on the 24th day of the first month, as I was by the side of the great river that is the Tigris," he continues, "I lifted mine eyes, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen, whose waist was girded with the gold of Euphaz." Now, Daniel is in that place by the river. He's out in nature, and he's praying. You know, one of the places I love to pray most is out in nature. Not far from where my wife and I live, there are trails, and often I will go on those trails and walk and lift my voice to God and seek God in prayer. If you really want to have a prayer experience with God, get away from the clamor, get away from the clutter, get away from the ringing cell phones and the honking horns, and get out in a quiet place in nature and pray. You say, "Well, look, I live in the city. I don't think I can find a place." Well, find a place in your room. Find some place to be quiet where you and God can communicate. Now, what happened to Daniel? He's out there praying. And what does it say? He says, "I lifted my eyes, and behold, a certain man." Who is that man? "Clothed in linen, whose waist was girded with the gold of Euphaz. His body was like beryl, his face like the appearance of lightning, his eyes like torches of fire, his arms and feet like burnished bronze in color." We go on. and the sound of his words like the voice of a multitude. Who is this that Daniel sees? Who is this that comes in answer to Daniel's prayer? Do you remember in Revelation chapter 1 when John on the island of Patmos had a similar vision? Now notice, and Daniel was alone. I saw the vision, for the men who were with me did not see the vision, but great terror fell on them so that they fled to hide themselves. Who was this? If you happen to have your Bible tonight, take it and turn to Revelation, the first chapter, because here in Revelation, you will see a very, very similar vision. Revelation chapter 1, we look there at verse 13. In the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like the Son of Man. Who's the Son of Man? Who is that? That's Jesus, isn't it? What's he like? He's clothed with a garment to the feet and girded with a chest with a golden band. We saw that in Daniel 10, didn't we? His head and his hair was white like wool, as white as snow, his eyes like the flame of fire, his feet like brass, and as if refined in a furnace. His voice was like the sound of many waters. This is the exact description, very, very, almost exactly to the detail. This description in Revelation 1 is the description of the being in Daniel 10. Daniel prays, and Jesus comes in answer to his prayer. That's pretty exciting, isn't it? As you and I are on our knees, Jesus listens. And does Jesus have a representative? Who's Jesus' representative? Jesus said, if I go away, I will send the Holy Spirit to you. And the Holy Spirit is the representative of Jesus, the third person of the Godhead. And as we pray, the Holy Spirit comes to give us wisdom. The Holy Spirit comes to help us to solve the riddles of our life. The Holy Spirit comes to give us guidance. The Holy Spirit comes to give us strength in our weakness. He comes to give us wisdom in our ignorance. He comes to give us enduring might in our frailty. So as we pray, just as Jesus came to Daniel, just as Jesus came to John, so he sends the third person of the Godhead, the Holy Spirit, to us to enlighten our mind, to illuminate our path that we walk through the Christian life. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you are with me. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28, verse 20, lo, I'm with you always. Hebrews chapter 10, Jesus said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. We seek him in prayer and we sense his presence. We sense him being around us. This is a vision of Christ, because there in Revelation 1, it says, in the midst of the seven candlesticks was one like the Son of Man. He's clothed with a garment down to the feet. He's girded about with a chest of a golden brand. Christ came amidst the candlesticks, amidst the churches. And through his Spirit, he still walks with us. He still impresses us. He still guides us. He still directs us. His head and his hair were like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like the flames of fire, the Bible says. His feet were like the feet of brass, Revelation 1:15. If refined in a furnace, his voice as the sound of many waters. Daniel 10 and Revelation 1 are parallel passages that describe Jesus. When you and I pray, Jesus is there. He is by our side. He is with us, and we are not alone. In the book of Daniel, Christ is pictured as someone who descends from heaven, coming close beside us. As Daniel continues to pray, something happens. Daniel sees Christ. He sees Christ in his iridescent glory. He sees Christ in his dazzling brightness. He sees Christ with all of his beauty and wonder. And in the presence of Jesus, Daniel faints. He cannot endure as a sinful human being the spectacular glory and the amazing wonder of Christ. The Bible says in Daniel 10, verse 8, therefore I was left alone when I saw this great vision. I had no strength remained in me, for my vigor was turned to frailty in me, and I retained no strength. He faints there. He just can't endure the glory of the presence of Christ. Yet I heard the sound of his words, and while I heard the sound of his words, I was in a deep sleep on my face, and with my face to the ground, because he couldn't endure the glory of Christ's presence any longer. Suddenly, a hand touches me, which made me tremble on my knees and on the palms of my hands. So a hand touches him. Jesus leaves, but he sends the angel Gabriel down, and Gabriel touches Daniel. And as he does, Daniel awakens, and Gabriel explains why he comes, and he explains that he's come to answer his prayer. And he said to me, O Daniel, O man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak to you and stand upright, for I have now come to you. Now notice two things. First, Daniel had been praying for 3 weeks. And during those 3 weeks, he had no apparent answer to his prayers. Have you ever prayed for a day? Not much has happened. 2 days, not much has happened. A week, not much has happened. 2 weeks, not much has happened. 3 weeks, and you said, God, my prayers are just going to the ceiling. They're bouncing back. Lord, my heart is so barren, I don't feel your answering. God began to answer Daniel's prayer the first day that he prayed, as we'll see. So the first thing you notice is this. Because there are no apparent answer to our prayers doesn't mean at all that God is not listening. The second thing we notice from this text is this. He said to me, O Daniel, man greatly beloved. You and I may be perplexed as we pray, but Daniel says, God says to us as he did to Daniel, you are my child, you are greatly beloved. You're my son, you're my daughter, you're greatly beloved. In prayer, we find the warmth and the intimacy with God. We find that sense of oneness with God. We find that sense that we are greatly beloved of God. We may not see the answer to our prayers immediately, but God is at work in ways that we may not know or understand. While he was speaking, this word came to me, and I stood trembling. So the angel is speaking to Daniel. He has come once Daniel has fainted. He's touched him. Daniel awakens. And as the angel comes, this is what the angel says to Daniel. Then he said to me, do not fear. That's what God says to you and me. Do not fear. Be filled with peace. Do not fear, Daniel, for from the first day, what day, everybody? What day? The first day that you set your heart to understand, the first day that you began praying and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard, and I've come because of your words. Now, this is rather interesting, isn't it? Daniel, from the first day that you began to pray, Gabriel says, your words were heard in heaven. So the first day that we begin to pray, our words are heard. We may not see the answer to our prayers. We may not understand the answer to our prayers. But from that very first day that we begin to pray, heaven hears. Now, why didn't God answer Daniel's prayer immediately? It is here in Daniel chapter 10 that we have the curtain drawn aside in the great controversy between good and evil. It is here more than any other place in the Bible that we understand this great controversy between good and evil, and that we understand why our prayers are not immediately answered. As we go on, we discover some of these amazing biblical truths. First, Daniel was a man greatly beloved. He was a man cherished by God. When you and I pray, we are cherished by God. Daniel 10 takes us behind the scenes in the great controversy between good and evil. It helps us to see what's happening as we pray. Now, why weren't Daniel's prayers immediately answered? Daniel 10, verse 13. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. And behold, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I had been left alone there with the kings of Persia. So now you have three beings here, three different groups. Let's back up and look here. The prince of the kingdom of Persia is fighting against Gabriel. We need to find out who's the prince of the kingdom of Persia. Well, obviously, it can't possibly be the king of Persia because that's somebody separate later on in the text. Remember Jesus, when he was on earth in John 12, says, the prince of this world comes and has nothing in me. Who's the prince of the world? Well, God created Adam and Eve. He gave them dominion over this earth. But when Adam and Eve sinned, they lost their dominion. So Satan became the prince of the power of the air, according to Ephesians 2. He became the prince of the world, according to John 12. So Satan was like the prince of Persia. He's the one that took over. So the Bible says the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstands Gabriel. He fights against him. He battles against him for 21 days. Who do they battle over? The Bible says they battle over the king of, or the kings of Persia. But Michael, one of the chief princes, now in the Hebrew language, it's the chief prince. So whoever Michael is, he's the chief prince. And he comes, he beats back the forces of hell. He beats back the devil who's battling over the mind of Cyrus. Why is he battling? Because he doesn't want Cyrus to sign the decree that the Israelites go free from captivity. What was Daniel praying for? He was praying and fasting for 3 weeks that the Israelites would go free. And as he's praying that, his prayers go up to heaven, God sends the angel Gabriel down. The angel Gabriel battles over the mind of Cyrus with the king of the princes of Persia, that is with Satan. And so there's this battle going on, and Gabriel wants to bring into Cyrus's mind light and truth, so he'll sign that decree. He wants to impress him. The devil, the prince of Persia at that point, wants to bring in darkness to keep the Israelites in captivity. So that battle, that great controversy, that intergalactic struggle, that struggle that's going on, that Star Wars is going on, and we can't see it, but it's happening. And so Michael comes. So who's the mighty Michael? Who is that? Notice, the Bible says for John 12, verse 31, now is the judgment of the world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. So the devil's the ruler of the world. We know that. He's going to be cast out. We know that. God respects our freedom of choice. So when we pray, there's this big struggle over the mind, this big conflict. We may be praying for something, but the devil, you may be praying for a son or a daughter that doesn't know Christ. You may be praying for a husband or wife that doesn't know Christ, a neighbor. And what's the devil doing? He's bringing darkness. What's Jesus doing? Through the angel Gabriel or angels, he's bringing light. So that why doesn't God answer the prayers immediately? Because God respects their freedom of choice. But when we pray, God respects our freedom of choice, and the river of water of life, the power of God comes through us to touch that other life. The power of God comes through us, and God redoubles the forces of heaven working on that other person. Let me put it this way. Isn't God doing everything he can to save your son or daughter, your husband or wife, who doesn't know Jesus? He is. He's doing everything he can. Isn't he sending angels? He is. But he's limited. Why is he limited? By their freedom of choice, of course. And what is Satan doing? Bringing darkness to their minds so they will not choose. What happens when we intercede? When we intercede, it gives God freedom because of our freedom of choice, our liberty, to work through us. And the Spirit of God comes pouring out through us to touch them in ways that wouldn't be touched. Our prayers ascend to heaven, and God looks at Satan and says, I have freedom now to do more, more. Can you limit the unlimitable God? According to Psalm 78, you can. It says the Israelites turned back and limited the God of Israel. So God can be limited by our choices. When you and I choose to pray for another, the ground rules of the controversy between good and evil say that God respects our freedom of choice, and therefore his power is poured out to touch the heart of that other person in fuller ways. Somebody says, I don't really understand that. Do you understand electricity? But I can just go throw a switch over there and turn these lights on? Can you fully explain to me electrical engineering and how all that electricity works? You may not be able to do that fully. Do you understand how that there can be pictures in this room floating in the air? You say, you're a crazy man. I know. Listen to me now. And I have a thing called a television. I turn that thing on, and those pictures come right through that television. Do you fully understand that? Do you fully understand radio frequencies? No, we don't understand fully electricity or television or radio frequencies, but does that stop you from taking your little remote and turning on the TV or turning on the radio or throwing a switch? Not at all. You don't have to understand everything about something to get the benefit of the something you don't understand everything about, right? And so we may not understand everything about intercessory prayer, but this we know, that all through the Bible, intercessory prayer works. Intercessory prayer is part of God's plan. we see in Daniel chapter 10. As Daniel prayed, there's this great controversy. God respects Daniel's freedom of choice. And as the result, the angel Gabriel comes to battle over the mind of Cyrus to beat back the force of hell. When that doesn't work, Michael comes down. And Michael battles. In this fight, the forces of God engage against the forces of Satan. And that's what we really need to understand, that there's a real controversy going on in the world, and there's a real battle between the force of good and the force of evil, the force of Christ and the forces of Satan. But as we pray, God redoubles the good angels, and they beat back the forces of evil. As we pray, the good angels come, and they enter this battle. But you say to me, who is this Michael? As Daniel is persistent in his prayers, a battle that was being lost by Gabriel, or at least not being won by Gabriel, is won by Michael. So who is this Michael? Well, let's look in the Bible and see if we can discover. The first mention of the book of Michael that we have is about Michael having this battle up in heaven against Satan when Satan rebelled in heaven. Revelation 12, verse 7, and war broke out in heaven. Now, that's a strange place for war, isn't it? Michael and his angels fought with the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought. But they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So Michael and his angels fight. The word Michael, you notice that last two letters of the word E-L, Michael. El comes from the word in the Hebrew, Elohim, meaning God. So what does Michael mean? One who is like God. So wherever Michael is in heaven, he's the one like God. Michael and his angels do what, everybody? They fight. And who do they fight against? They fight against the devil and his angels. And what happens to the devil and his angels? They're cast out of heaven. They do not prevail. So whoever Michael is, he has the absolute power and authority to cast Satan out of heaven. So Michael is the one like God who can cast Satan out of heaven. That's what the Bible says in Revelation 12, verse 9. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast with him. So the great dragon is who? That's the devil. The devil is called the dragon, and he's called the serpent. He is the serpent because he deceives. He's the dragon because he destroys. So here, the devil is cast out of heaven, and he comes to deceive the world. Who casts him out? Michael, the one who is like God, has that authority, has that power. So whoever Michael is, he has authority, divine authority, because he is the one like God. He has divine power because he is the one like God. He has divine knowledge because he is the one like God. So what does he do? He casts Satan out of heaven. Now, the next mention that we find of Michael after this rebellion in heaven, after Satan is cast out, is in Jude 1, verse 9. Yet Michael the archangel. What does it mean about what is the meaning of archangel? Archangel is the one who's the commander-in-chief of all the angels. In contending with the devil, he disputes about the body of Moses. Dared not bring against him a reviling accusation, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." Moses died before ever entering the earthly promised land. And Moses was resurrected from the dead and brought to heaven. Whoever Michael is, he has the power over the grave to raise Moses from the dead. So we've learned three things about Michael. The name means one who is like God. Second, Michael is the one who has power and authority to cast Satan out of heaven. Third, Michael is the one who can raise Moses from the dead. He has the power over death. You say, this sounds a lot like Jesus. It is. But you say, I'm a little confused because it says Michael the archangel. Is Jesus an archangel? Is Jesus a created being? Jesus is not a created being. Jesus existed from eternity in the past. He'll exist from eternity in the future. He is Alpha and Omega. He is the eternal Christ. He is the one that was, is, and ever will be. You say, what about this archangel business, the name archangel? That name means that he is the commander-in-chief of all the angels. And do you see the word arch too? The word arch comes from arche in the original language. And it means he's the beginner of, or the creator of, all the angels. Michael has the authority to cast Satan out of heaven. He has the authority over death. Must be Jesus. Jesus Christ, of course, is the only one that has that authority. Now, you say, what about Archangel? This is going to help you. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 16. The Lord himself, who is it? The Lord who? Himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel. Wow, this is Jesus. He comes with the voice of the archangel. What does this mean? Well, Matthew 16, verse 27 and 28, lightning shines from the east even unto the west, so will the coming of the Son of Man be, and he'll come to gather the righteous with his angels. So Jesus is the commander-in-chief of the angels, not a created being. He existed from eternity, but Jesus comes with the voice of the archangel. That is the command. He is the commander of all the angels. With the trumpet of God, the dead in Christ will rise first. And then the Bible says, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet the Lord where? To meet the Lord in the air. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. We'll always be with the Lord. So Jesus Christ is the one that comes as the commander-in-chief of all the angels. The lightning flashes, the thunder crashes, the earth shakes. Jesus descends down the corridor of the sky. The righteous dead are resurrected. The righteous living receive glorious immortal bodies with the righteous dead, and they're caught up to meet Jesus. In the Bible, only 5 times Michael is mentioned. Once in Revelation 12, 7 to 9. Once in Jude, there, chapter, only one chapter, but Jude 9. In 3 times in the book of Daniel. Daniel 10 mentioned twice. Daniel 12 mentioned once. Every time Michael is mentioned in the Bible, it's mentioned as Jesus, as the mighty warrior, Jesus as the conquering king, Jesus as the one triumphant over the evil powers of hell and the mighty conqueror over Satan. Now, there are many names of Jesus in the Bible. Jesus is the lamb, the dying sacrifice. Jesus is the door, the way to the Father. Jesus is the rock of ages, the solid ground between our feet. Jesus is the lion of the tribe of Judah, the victorious one. Jesus is the prince of peace that'll bring peace to the world. Jesus is the good shepherd, the one that guides us and directs us home. Jesus is the rose of Sharon, the one that perfumes our lives. Jesus is the lily of the valley, the one that makes all things beautiful. Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. Why are there so many different names of Jesus in the Bible? Why is it that he is pictured with so many different images? Because he is the infinite Christ. He is the water of life that satisfies our inner thirst. He is the bread of life that satisfies our soul hunger. He is the way, the truth, and the life. See, so many names of Jesus. Michael is a special name of Jesus. Michael is a special name of Jesus. When the Bible uses Michael in those 5 instances, every time he is in conflict with Satan, and every time he is the mighty conqueror, every time he is the victorious Lord, Michael is the powerful commander-in-chief of all the angels. And when we're on our knees praying, and we're battling with some sin in our life, battling with some habit in our life, when we are bound by the chains of sin, and we pray, Jesus, the mighty commander-in-chief of the angels, the one who's never lost a battle, sends his angels in answer to our prayer. The devil is beaten back, and Jesus comes across as conqueror in our lives. Here is the incredible good news. When we are praying for a son, a daughter, a husband, or wife, a neighbor that doesn't know Christ, a working associate, a dear friend, we pray, and Jesus, the mighty conqueror, sends those angels of heaven down to beat back the forces of hell. Notice again, Daniel 12, verse 1. At that time, Michael shall stand up. Who is he? He is the great prince that stands watch over the sons of your people. He is the great prince. At that time, Michael stands up Remember in Daniel chapter 7, Michael sat down in the judgment. Jesus sat down, the Son of Man, in the judgment. Here in Daniel chapter 12, Michael stands up. Judgment is over. The time of trouble begins. There shall be a time of trouble since there never was, since there was a nation. Even that time, and at that time, your people shall be delivered, everyone who's found written in the book. Daniel 7, Michael sits down, the Son of Man sits down, Father, Son meet together. The divine drama of destiny, the judgment in heaven takes place. Here, the destinies of all human beings are to be decided. Here, Jesus is to reveal that judgment will be passed in favor of the people of God. Here in Daniel chapter 7, the judgment begins. Jesus steps forward. He sees those that have accepted Christ, those for whom their lives have been committed totally, completely to Christ. Jesus stands up. The devil tries to condemn us. Jesus says, "This man, this woman is one of mine." That judgment goes on. We discover that that judgment began at the end of the 2300-year prophecy in 1844. But here, at the end of time, when the destinies of all human beings have come up before God, when Jesus has revealed through his people that they would rather die than be disloyal to him, when they are totally committed to him, Michael stands up. As he does, there is a time of trouble. This world is plunged into a time of difficulty, trouble. But at that time, Jesus eventually will come to deliver his people, everyone found written in the book. Wherever Michael appears in Scripture, there is deliverance. Wherever Michael appears in Scripture, there is victory. Jesus has never lost a battle with Satan yet. Prayer lodged at the throne of God produces amazing results. Daniel 10, verse 19. Jesus speaks. He says, "O man," that's Daniel, "greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be to you. Be strong." Yes, be strong. The words come echoing and re-echoing down through the centuries. God speaks to you, my brother, my sister. He says, "O man, O woman, greatly beloved." He says, "I haven't forgotten you. You're not a speck of cosmic dust." He says, "Oh man, greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be to you. Do not fear. Lay your fears aside. Grasp the reality that I am the victorious Lord. Peace be unto you. Be strong." Yes, be strong. God is speaking to you this very moment. Be strong. Be strong. Not in your own strength, but in Christ's strength. As you kneel to pray, sense his presence. As you walk on that quiet path, sense his presence. Sense his strength flowing into your life. Be strong. Yes, be strong. He will take your frailty and turn it into his enduring might. He will take your weakness and turn it into his strength. He will take your worry and turn it into his peace. He will take your fears and turn them into joy. Be strong. Yes, be strong as we pray. Father in heaven, we sense that you are the Almighty God, that you, the divine Son of God, have conquered over Satan. You've crushed the forces of hell. That we hear your voice. Be strong, my child, in my strength. And so tonight we open our hearts to receive your strength. And Lord, thank you for the call to be strong, not in our strength, but in yours. And by faith we grasp your strength. In Jesus' name, amen.